Yikes! Looks like some drama happening on that side of the stage. Although, over on this side, nothing but smiles. Me and Gibbler still very much in that predictions tournament. We got another good match coming up for you guys. We got Lead Paint versus APX Void. Lead Paint hailing from Grand National Champions. APX Void making his comeback into Hearthstone. He took some time off to do some of his own personal stuff and then came back into Hearthstone to prepare for this preliminary.
Yeah, we saw him, I believe, lose in just the very last match of the spring preliminary. I believe he lost to Dear Jason narrowly there. And, you know, hopefully for him at least, he can have a run that doesn't quite end right there this weekend.
Yeah, certainly. And if he's getting really close before, hopefully he's able to repeat that before. Again, consistency is definitely the name of the game in a card game like Hearthstone. So we have the lists in front of us. APX Void is going to start off with this Tempo Mage. He's a player that's been well known to love this deck. Him, Hotform, and a few other players, they swear by this deck. And then we have Lead Paint sticking with his aggressive shaman. He has this, his dragon warrior, his Rena warlock, and a token druid.
Yeah, I really like his naming convention for his lists. I believe he called his lists comely, felicity, melancholy, and what was his dragon warrior? It was serendipities.
Is it the description of his emotions that he feels?
I'm not entirely sure, but it definitely leads to a little bit more interesting than just custom Warlock 3 or whatever some of the other decks
answer. Maybe former significant others.
He's got some weird names of significant others if he dated someone named Melancholy.
But yeah. Maybe their parents didn't do a good job naming
them. Who knows?
Felicity could be the way that he feels about this deck, reminds him of a simpler time. Going into this matchup specifically, I do know that statistically, Tempo Mage does struggle a lot with the aggressive shaman, although I can't really understand too much why. Both fight for early game board, and I do feel like it can. I do feel like it's a lot more even than the statistics lead.
I think the aggressive shaman deck just has more solid early minions and better cheap removal in that's unconditional. The shaman deck is able to, well, let's just look at this right here. You know, the Tunnel Trogs can get out of hand really quickly and has access to more of those early minions that are strong. You have Tunnel Trogs in addition to the Argent Squires, which can pair with Flame Tongue to get advantageous trades and things like that. It can be difficult for the sort of longer game plan of the Tempo Mage deck to take fruition.
I can definitely see that, where the board early on just gets too much to handle with something like this. Not every shaman starts off this fast with
not quite
three one-mana plays, as well as a lightning bolt to supplant its overload synergy. But Lead Paint is stuck with a turn relatively weak.
Yeah, he is basically just going to have to use his hero power this turn. Not going to waste a Rock Fighter to get a little bit of damage in right away, though there is a face there, and he just missed three damage. Sir Twitch chat will let him know that.
Yeah. It's too bad, but at least he still has the board control for now. Void very much thinking about just playing the removal game because Mana Worm is very vulnerable. It's just one of those things too where if you play Fireball and then your opponent plays a reasonably big minion, whether the thing from below or the Flaming Faceless, it's going to be really hard to remove that too.
Faceless has to be what he's really afraid of right now in terms of not wanting to use his Fireball, because right now his Mana Worm would be a really, really passive play. It doesn't really accomplish much in the board. Any overload card could just kill his Tunnel Trog, or rather his Mana Worm with the Tunnel Trog pretty much for free. There's lots of ways that this can go down that go very badly for him. But it will just be, well, there is the Flame Wreath Faceless. So exactly what he may have feared would have come to fruition. And now Lead Paint is kind of an interesting spot because he could choose to play the Flame Wreath Faceless, which would pump his Trog, but this is, he's gonna go ahead and try and preserve his Tunnel Trog rather than getting it into ping range.
Ouch.
And gets a really fortunate Tuskar Totemic Bear getting the Totem Golem, and this might be why.
Maybe that's why
this could very well be why the Aggro Shaman decks end up big ahead.
Yeah, that's really nasty. Void can still pick up cards like Flame Strike. It's not something to discount at all. The Lead Paint still has a lot more where that came from. Finley coming here fills out the rest of the mana curve. He can start trading into the Azure Drake.
If he really wants to, he can just Lava Burst that Drake and just send everything to the face as well. APX Void's list does have one copy of Flame Strike, but also two copies of Firelance Portal, which is not nearly as effective on this kind of board at allowing him to get back into the game. will be some trades on the board and just pushing damage to the face, getting the Flaming Faceless down to set up for next turn.
Ah, man, it's going to be so difficult to come back here. So Fireball, the hero power, and there is 9 damage remaining. It's half your life.
And Lead Paint also just has that Lava Burst, which could pump up his Totem Golem if he wants to fire it off right away. Also has the spell power from the Totem. So getting that in now could be pretty attractive, especially considering he is getting into 7 mana, which would allow APX Forward to potentially cast Flame Strike. So he doesn't really want to commit that Totem Golem to the board here necessarily.
Yeah, I like the Lava Burst. 6 damage, dealing an extra 2 because the Tunnel Charge gets buffed. So that's an 8 damage Lava Burst if you think about it.
Yeah.
How does it get any stronger than that?
He would put, yeah, he's actually just going to go ahead and Hero Power and send his minion in. This is a little bit more conservative. He saves the Lava Burst in case he maybe needs it for removal for, I'm not really entirely sure what his plan would be with it.
Well, he's saving his Lava Burst just to see, maybe surprise his opponent so that way he plays a little bit less conservative, because sometimes if you just put the burst onto your opponent, you make them really worried
about
stuff.
Look at this game now. He's lost his Tunnel Truck, so he's missing the damage he'd get off of the Tunnel Truck for the Lava Burst. He would have done an additional...
Well, he's lethal now.
Well, now we do that. But actually, I don't...
He would have been one off.
Does he actually have it? No, he's one off because he can't actually... Oh, no, he's a little spell damage. Never mind.
Yeah, yeah. So he would have been one off without it. But it's like one of those things where I guess you're afraid of potential Cabal's Tome shenanigans.
Sure,
maybe.
Sure. Yeah. Maybe, but what would he tome into that would terrify you there?
An ice block or an ice barrier, and then maybe you could stall until Yogg-Saron. It's one of those things, too. So all things considering, Apex Void... I do feel like he did get the unfortunate end of the stick of the first game queue. That is something that's always going to be really problematic when you bring something that's like just like every one of his decks is weak, is a little bit weak to something in Lead Paint's lineup. And Lead Paint starts off with a really good win, and I think he's going to need it because he has Reyna Warlock, and that's a deck that forever will be under the fire, and at least in the Whispers of the Old Gods slash early Karazhan meta. People just don't like bringing that deck to tournaments, and yet some players are still loyal to it.
Yeah, there have been a lot of Reyna Warlock decks, not nearly as many as showed up back in the spring season, but they've really gradually trickled out of the scene in favor of Zoo, and we've kind of seen why. It's been a deck that's really struggled very often.
Right, and the reason you'd bring it is so that way you can be strong against all the Warriors, but then you open yourself up to the rest of the lineups, such as the Shaman decks, the Warlock, the Zoo Warlocks. Although Lead Paint did ban the Zoo Warlock, which is interesting. We haven't seen a Warlock ban in a very long time. I do know another player who really stuck by that plan 6-0, got really far last week, fell at the very last game, but he also thinks that strategy is very good too.
He failed to win with his Reyna Warlock deck, ultimately. So,
up against the Freeze Mage, it's when he had both Ram Shield off the Xeris.
Yeah, the Shifter Xeris at the Bulf was nearly the most amazing moment. But
if you don't like that game, you don't like Hearthstone, as far as I'm concerned.
It was amazing.
Yeah, that game was crazy. But this one is going to be Druid versus the Tempo Mage. Is Tempo Mage, well, he's playing Firelands Portal. How does that dynamic change his matchup, if at all?
Firelands Portal, I think, is much better than Flame Strike, which is typically the card that a lot of Tempo Mage decks have in that spot in this matchup. It gives you more reach. You just have more damage you can go to face. As we saw, actually, in just the last match, it enables you to clear through Ancient of War with Azure Drake and actually develop a minion at the same time. So I think that is definitely a card that makes this matchup considerably better.
Lead Paint has a pretty decent hand with Innervate and Violet Teacher, but just has to survive that early game pressure that APX Void puts out there. He's got a lot of choices. Chooses the Cold Sorcerer just because it's, you know, you will be able to use Sorcerer's Apprentice for a more swingy turn.
All right, Lead Paint goes with the Innervate into Nourish.
Yep, I have to imagine gaining mana crystals here.
Just trying to set himself up for those powerful later turns. Yeah. He has a second Nourish to find cards, so already up to 6 mana, going to 7 in his following turn.
So next turn, he's going to have the equivalent mana of APX Voice's next 2 turns.
Yeah.
He has 7 mana crystals. APX Voice is going to have 7 crystals over 2 turns.
All right, well, Mulch is not super exciting here. He could just go ahead. Yeah, he does actually end up having the Violet Teacher into Mulch to slow down APX Void a little bit. We'll see what comes off the Mulch. But the key here is that he's slowing down the early aggression, and that's where the Tempo Mage deck has its strength in the matchup.
Ooh. Important draw there to remove the Violet Teacher as well.
He does have, APX Void does have the Sorcerer's Apprentice, so he could play Sorcerer's Apprentice and then coin out the Fireball to develop a little bit more to his board.
I like that.
Does leave him open to a possible swipe, but Leadpain only has a single card in his hand.
Okay. So he Arcane Missiles first to see if he can hit twice and then play a proactive four-mana minion as well.
Okay, this, yeah, I like this from APX Void because the Water Elemental is much more stable against any of the removal that Leadpain would be able to bring to bear here.
Wow. Arcane Missiles math is actually very complicated if you start thinking about it.
Because
if you cast it and one of the early game missiles takes out the 1-1, that changes the odds significantly. But if he at least hit it twice, that was the key there. Leadpain has that nourish, hit some of his heavy hitting minions.
And frankly, that's really what he's looking for at this point. He's developed so much mana. He's still at a healthy 27 life now, thanks to the armor from Shapeshift. And he really just needs to sort of start playing those late game bombs while APX Void is still kind of struggling to get any sort of significant development on the board.
Yeah, but this is one of the best you can get. Two Firelands portals. Now, Kibler, we were making some friendly wagers on what we think the Firelands portals will summon. You said you didn't actually say anything that you think it would be. I told you that that would be Captain Greenskin or Starving Buzzard.
I'm going for Doomguard.
Oh, yeah? Oh, that's right. You said it was Doomguard. Doomguard or Leeroy, right?
Yeah.
Just for the crazy swing on the board that it can provide.
Does not have access to the Fireless Portal just yet. Shifting Shade is kind of interesting. There are actually a lot of good cards in Druid you could pick up, but this Ragnaros is doing... this Ragnaros is already doing a lot of work on this board. It's very difficult for APX Void to remove, and Leadpain, the longer it stays in play, the more of an advantage he's gaining from its effect every turn.
I'm trying to think about like what's the best usage of mana here. I do like Wrath on the 4-3 on some kind, so that way you can make it very easy. Ooh, Fandral, does that change it?
I don't think so.
No. I still like the Sylvanas play, too.
Yeah, I kind of like playing Sylvanas rather than Fandral here as well, simply because you know, your opponent can't really... Whoa, okay.
Well, you definitely play the Power of the Wild.
Now I like his play. Now I really like that play.
Shoot the Water Elemental.
All right, does not get the Water Elemental, but this game is really pretty much out of reach for APX Void, it feels. He is able to play the Sorcerer's Apprentice, and looks like he's... Is that a fire? No, Raven Idol. I didn't even see the Raven Idol. That's kind of cool.
Wait, but he discovers a mage spell.
He does.
Forbidden Flame is it enough? He has what on the board? He has a Water Elemental, so it only does 5 damage for Forbidden Flame. Mirror Entity is also surprisingly very useful against the hand. Chooses the Mirror Image just probably to have anti-Ragnaros tech.
Yeah, he's leaving himself with more of a board that the Ragnaros can fire onto, which works out very well. And you know, here, maybe Sylvanas might have ended up being better, given the way that the turn actually ended up playing out. Because now Leadpain in a position, well, Swipe and Living Roots can pretty much clear everything off the board if he wants and just start sending damage to face.
I do like eventually getting Sylvanas out. There is an interaction with Sylvanas and Firelands Portal where if you Firelands Portal, Sylvanas will steal the minion. So it is one of those really annoying things that they already use Fireball, so they can't really remove it in a convenient way with one spell.
And it's going to go ahead and take out the Sorcerer's Apprentice. Doesn't want APX Void to get any cheap spells here. And we shall see where Ragnaros goes. Can Ragnaros even really kill a Water Elemental? It's just made of water.
It can. Enough fire can extinguish anything.
It did not.
Well, he doesn't want to because he wants to extinguish the person who summoned
Maybe
the Water
he,
Elemental.
Maybe he called a truce with Neptulon. He's like, I'll leave your people alone.
That's way above my head. You have to ask Nimsh for a proper response on that one in terms
All
of
right.
Warcraft lore.
I will.
Okay. I have his number.
All right, Firelands Portal on Ragnaros. It is Ooh, that's not Doomguy, but that's also really good.
Is it? It's an interesting spot where like you don't want it to be too good because then Sylvanas
gets better.
It's true.
No,
the
thing is that Apex Void, you know, yeah, he needs to get rid of this Ragnaros, but doesn't want to put himself in a position where Lead Paint can get a great exchange. Does have the second mirror image, so.
Right.
Now this is kind of a weird spot because he has so many minions in play. Does he even really want to remove the Ragnaros with one of the minions that can actually attack? Probably still.
Yeah, I think you still want to kill Ragnaros just because of the long-term implications of the damage. What if it hits phase and all of a sudden you're down to 3 health?
It's true. He is still just 11 life. And if there were something like a spell power swipe there, it'd be really, really bad for him. So
yeah, swipe here can't guarantee the kill. The steal on the Earth Elemental.
It's true. That Earth Elemental definitely made things very interesting. This is a game that looked like Lead Paint was just totally running away with, but a bunch of small minions to potentially absorb rag hits, and then pretty big Firelands portal, really turning things around.
Are you a fan of just playing Drew the Claw and then just like not addressing the Earth Elemental so that way you can just start picking apart the board? Say you play Drew the Claw, whether in charge or taunt, either, and then you just kind of help Sylvanas attack to keep it healthy, and then all of a sudden have it just threaten whatever comes out next.
But then your opponent can just attack the Druid of the Claw with their Earth Elemental, and then what, do you trade your Sylvanas and your Druid of the Claw for their Earth Elemental? Doesn't end up working out.
Minions either themselves. I guess it's all right. Well, in the end,
it looks like he's just going to trade and take the 0-1. All right. Interesting. Now, you look at just the face of Lead Paint there. He's like, this did not work out. And it worked out very well.
It felt like they could have gotten bigger value on that.
It really felt like that was, I don't know, really awkward. He used a bunch of resources to kill the Earth Elemental and a bunch of 1-1, or 0-2s even.
He had Drew the Claw as well, which is actual synergy with Savage Roar in case he wanted to finish the game. He could have at least... Well, I guess he didn't want to gamble on the 50-50 of missing the Earth Elemental, and all of a sudden the 7-3 is like challenging his 0-1 that he stole. So he'd rather, he says, if I can't have it, then nobody can have it.
And now, you know, APX Void, he has the Flame Strike to clear off this board and just start marching with that Water Elemental. The life total may be 6-23, but Lead Paint is totally out of cards. He's already used both Nourishes.
That's a big one.
That's an Ancient of War.
It's going to draw a lot of resources out from APX Void. That Firelands portal, though, can also be huge.
Yeah, and there's a Frostbolt, too, so there's no way that this Water Elemental can end up attacking for lethal with the Hero Power next turn. There's also just a bunch of Burn with a Flame Waker.
Okay, yeah. The Arcane Missiles, Arcane Blast, Frostbolt. So that gives you 6 extra Flame Waker shots.
I don't think we'll see the Flame Waker here. I think that it's just much safer to Frostbolt plus Firelands Portal plus Arcane Blast to take this out, get a 5-drop, hit your opponent.
You get an extra 11 shots, though. So
you do get a lot of shots.
Plus it gets a ton of shots. So the chances of clearing it, that's not a very good start. He needs this to hit at least twice, I think. Okay.
This is going quite poorly now. I mean, he does have the Firelands portal remaining in his hand. He could just ping his opponent's face, and that's exactly what he'll do.
Okay.
And he's waiting with the Firelands portal to finish it off next turn. Power of the Wild, that does very little. Lead Paint had such an explosive start to this game, but APX Void was able to turn it around in the course of what seemed like just 1 or 2 turns.
He had 2 Nourishes, 2 Wild Growths, an Innervate, and Violet Teacher, Fandral plays. But APX Void kind of out-grinding him, out-resourcing him.
And Firelands Portal? Is it another Earth Elemental?
Oh, man. Maybe that Doomguard you're talking about.
Oh!
Well, that makes that
is
awkward.
Kind of funny.
Naga Sea Witch makes Yogg-Saron cost only 5 mana.
It also makes Arcane Blast cost 5 mana, so, a little bit Calm A, Calm B.
Ooh, man, Lead Paint was praying for the Yogg. Did not get it. Yogg is nowhere to be seen.
And APX Void just has lethal on board here. Nothing Lead Paint can do.
I concede.
And wow, that was such a turnaround. That Firelance Portal into Earth Element. It feels like Lead Paint could have done something differently. The way that he navigated his Sylvanas, the way that he just played that sequence of turns. We were talking about the Fandral turn where he drew the Fandral off of, I believe it was a cycle for something. I'm trying to remember exactly what it was. But he chose to play the Fandral into Wrath, that into the Power of the Wild that he drew, rather than play the Sylvanas that turn. And then he kind of got his board blown up that turn. It feels like if he'd played Sylvanas that turn, things might have gone a bit differently.
Yeah, I do feel like that was the case, because then the mage never really gets back that board control, even if it's just a little tiny water elemental. Right. And then, you know, you never know if that's able to help pick apart the mirror images. Ragnaros is a little bit longer. It's all a bunch of what ifs, but I think if there's anything that I can definitely vouch for, is like, I think Lead Paint definitely has a good positive attitude. Mm-hmm. Lead Paint's one of those players who's just very hard to tilt, I think. He's a player that's generally very positive, and he's whenever I met him at events, he was just so happy to be there playing Hearthstone. So it feels like this kind of small mistakes here won't really set him off his game plan too much.
Yeah, he was just sort of smiling and crinkling his nose, not like, you know, letting out these like exasperated sighs.
Yeah,
even when an Earth Elemental comes up in Firelands Portal.
Yeah,
so
for sure.
Definitely the right attitude to have.
All right, so the Mage and the Shaman are done, leading us to a 1-1 score. Let's go into game number 3, Druid versus Druid, one of the more important matchups in almost any lineups. I think Druid's like a deck that I think a lot of people would just bring because it doesn't lose too hard to anything, maybe the exception to Shaman. And potentially the control Shaman, but you know, you are expecting to win with it against anything too. It's very decent against the field. This matchup still feels a little bit volatile based off the early game openings.
Of which APX Void has about the worst I've seen.
Yeah, he's got a situational removal and almost every expensive minion that he has.
Oh, there's a lot of expensive minions in this deck. Let's not get too crazy here. He's still got, I think there's an Onyxia left in his deck, another Ancient. Actually, the Emperor is right in his hand. Okay, so yeah, he's got most of the heavy hitters, but this is a deck full of them.
Yeah, now Lead Paint gets to go first. APX Void not happy that he had to pass, and Lead Paint got that Wild Growth. And he does have a turn 3 play, so what he could hope for is Lead Paint to not have a very strong play on this turn, which he does have the Druid the Claw, so that is already starting to get a little bit dicey. There is also the availability of Nourishing this turn.
Yeah, the coin into Nourish could set him up for a... yeah, it looks good. What's he's going to do could set him up into a Ragnaros very soon. Is just going to go ahead and wrap this off. Interesting. This feels like a matchup to me, in my experience, that's very often been one where the game comes down to more like big board swings than something like a 3-2 hitting you. And expending a resource like that in order to kill your opponent's 3-2 doesn't feel like it necessarily is what you want to be doing.
Yeah, it definitely is something to consider too, but I think his plan changed when he saw Ragnaros in his hand, and he also has, you know, Raven Idol and Swipe, so what he needs to do is have Ragnaros hit the board and make sure it sticks. You know, interestingly enough, that plays into APX Void's hand, which is you play slow, big minions, I mulch it, and I stall until I hit my big minions. So it could be one of the scenarios where Lead Paint tries to be pretty aggressive with his hand and ends up getting punished.
All right, well, he is going to deviate from the Ragnaros on 8 mana, picks up the Raven Idol, going to go ahead and make at least a reasonably big Violet Teacher board. No, actually not many good options for him here.
He can Mark of Nature the Violet Teacher, I guess. Make it harder
he can
to
make
kill.
A big Violet Teacher here, able to develop a couple of students.
Yeah, it's 3-9 is nothing to scoff at.
The health of a Violet Teacher is very relevant in this matchup because the swipe hero power is a very natural play in this matchup on 6 mana, which is exactly where APX Void is. So preserving that Violet Teacher and ensuring that it's going to be able to stick to the board for a little while definitely has quite a bit of value. And he, as we see, may very well just bait out a mulch, which clears the way for Ragnaros.
Yeah, it's not a bad mulch on Void's side at all. This is one of the highest priority removal targets. It's got buffed by a Raven Idol, so you're killing 2 cards for 1, although you do give a card to your opponent, so it cancels out mulch's bad, and I put that in air quotes, effect. But now Lead Paint can just play Ragnaros onto the board pretty confidently. One mulch has been used.
And there's only a single copy in either player's deck, so yes. Leadpate knows that this Ragnaros is here to stay, at least until it's time for the God of Death or a lot of swipes.
He can stall until that point. He has Ancient of War, which can absorb a lot of that damage, even survive the first Fire Blast from our Fire Lord.
Well, there will be a big tree available for Leadpaint as well. Yeah, looks like he's going to go ahead and cast it pretty quickly. One problem for APX Void, even if he does make it to that Yogg-Saron, he's mostly just drawn minions this game. He hasn't cast that many spells. So
that's
even if he
point.
Is able to hang on, he'll have a very, very low impact Yogg-Saron when he does get to that stage of the game.
So he has played two or three spells?
I think it's something like that, yeah. And, ooh, well, Ragnaros knows what he wants to do, which is burn APX Void's face into a crisp.
Yeah, I feel like that's what Ragnaros is doing a lot. I mean, Leadpaint also missed Ragnaros missed a few minions back in the previous game, which also could have helped him had board control, but also put him within range of killing. So this is one of the things that Ragnaros does, just so much pressure either way.
And APX Void now, he can play another another Ancient here, but that doesn't do too much. Leadpaint could just attack into it and ensure that his Ragnaros is able to take out one of them, or just keep raining fire down an APX Void. Definitely a tough spot.
Could ramp to Yogg-Saron.
Yeah, it's true. That may be his best option could be to just cast the Wild Growth. He actually, I believe, cast Nourish for Mana, Wild Growth, and the Feral Rage this turn. Because he could actually get two spells off the Wild Growth because he gets the once he gets 10 mana from the Nourish Clip for mana.
You do have ways to refill your hand. I do feel like I want to somehow get out to the Yogg-Saron plan if this Ragnaros chooses to miss. But there's also this weird possibility that Ragnaros hits the face and all of a sudden you're within burn range too.
Because true.
Hypothetically, is there a way for Leadpaint to set up potential lethal?
Just looking at Savage Roar plus Swipe here, it looks like if he Savage Roars, he's actually, I think, a little bit off. Savage Roar plus Swipe. I don't think he can quite get through all the health on the minions and get the damage into the face.
So why not set up for a scenario where either way it works? You can swipe the face, perhaps, and then set up that Ragnaros kills the minion, mm-hmm. or kills your opponent.
Yeah, that's definitely an option available for Leadpaint here. Regardless of what he ends up doing here, it's definitely a great position still. This Ragnaros has gone unchecked for quite a while.
Yeah, I don't mind that. If he swipes the face, he has the ability to Savage Roar as well and mm-hmm. kill off one of the minions, trade in his Ancient of War. It does feel like a pretty good opportunity just to try to end the game.
Yeah, it puts him at a 50% chance of just Ragnaros ending the game immediately. Is able to clear off. Because he's debating exactly how he wants to attack here, whether he wants to, clear up this. It says either Ragnaros kills you or kills your minions. So
sure.
Not guaranteed lethal, but guaranteed you're in a terrible position. And it is not the face this time, so APX Void has a stay of execution for a moment.
I'm surprised he didn't choose to use the Innervate there to innervate a minion, but I guess in this position, Leadpaint just wants to be a little bit conservative with his resources because he's not sure the outcome of the results here.
Yeah, and setting up Emperor, and I imagine, Feral Rage 4 armor here is going to set APX Void to a point where he's not going to be killed by Ragnaros next turn, even if it does go face, and now he's going to have Yogg-Saron available.
Okay, so now he can play out his entire hand, which I'm definitely a big favor of. Or perhaps playing around the Yogg-Saron, don't want to put everything into the board only to just get it wiped.
Yeah, Leadpaint choosing not to set up for the Doom or Twisting Nether, leaving him with zero resources.
Sure. Okay, well, but
Rag
he's at
knows
six
what he,
health.
Rag knows what he wants.
That's dangerous range.
It certainly is.
Because you're never sure if your opponent is going to kill himself with the Ragnaros, or sorry, with the Yogg-Saron. Does he have an alternative play? He picked up Living Roots and Swipe.
I don't really see a great option. There's Azure Drake plus Living Roots Swipe, which can clear most things. He actually
clears off almost everything except for 3-1, unfortunately.
Yeah.
If he had just a little bit extra damage, he would have been able to target Ragnaros twice over.
All right, it will not be Yogg-Saron for APX Void here. He is going to go ahead and take the swipe on Ragnaros. Or maybe not.
Oh, no, the Emperor can attack, so it does clear, actually.
Oh, yeah, you're absolutely right. I was thinking, I was missing the spell damage on the... Well, no, he can't take out both of them. Yeah, he's still... Oh, no, he's hero power. You're right. Totally right.
He clears it because
the mana left over from the hero power.
So that leaves him just barely alive. But Lead Paint already did use Drew the Claw. He already did use Swipe.
Mm-hmm. He's just at four lives.
This is a pretty good position for APX Void.
This has, again, been a huge turnaround for APX Void. He was in just under pressure from Ragnaros for so long, and yet here he is again with an incredible comeback.
I gotta say that Lead Paint, he's playing around Yaxxaron, but at the same time, if his minion was on board any turn before this, he would actually have the lethal this turn.
Yep.
And instead, he's played really slow and giving his opponent a chance to actually come back. Although, APX Void again is really low, and down to the point where Hellfire actually kills him, too. You have to hero power first.
All right, well, APX Void is going to go digging with Wild Growth Cycles.
Yeah. Probably best to avoid playing Yaxxaron at all costs if you don't have to.
At this point, yeah, he is definitely trying to avoid running into the self-lethal with Yogg.
Ooh.
But he's got a lot of resources all of a sudden.
Yeah, he can pick up so much life gain with these double Raven Idols. He can also pick up other ways to potentially finish the game.
He's got lethal here.
9 damage lethal on board. Mark of the Wild is an extra 2. So he's got 9 damage with Power of the Wild. So he's at 13 damage.
Not quite enough.
What to do?
He still has a second Raven Idol to try and discover here. So Mark of the Wild both allows him to potentially pressure as well as offers a tool for potentially trading in, protecting himself. Does choose to go ahead and Mark of the Wild immediately. Clear off Fandral.
Okay, so he's running out of time. He obviously would have wanted to Raven Idol first. And with this Raven Idol, he's only given like 1 second to choose. And it was another Raven Idol.
All right.
I think it was Nourish.
And Swipe here would just close it out. It is not Swipe, it's Onyxia. But is that going to be enough? It does give Lead Paint a huge board, but there is that Raven Idol waiting in the hand. Not quite lethal available for APX Void just yet.
He has 14 through Power of the Wild. He can pick up lethal through a lot of cards. There's Swipe. There's
Starfire.
I believe another
Power of the Wild is lethal as well, or not quite.
I think that would be a little bit off.
He has 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 18. Yeah, you're right. Power of the Wild is not quite enough. So he will go Raven Idol if he finds one of several cards he can close out this game.
Starfire.
I believe that is going to be enough. What a crazy game.
Yeah.
This is just back-to-back games where Ragnaros sat in the board for multiple turns, but Lead Paint just wasn't able to ultimately close it out.
Yeah, so APX Void gets the lead, but again, I do feel like the fate was in Lead Paint's hands. He could have put out the 3-5 with an Innervate. He held on to Innervate for just a hero power later on. He was really concerned about the inevitable Yaxxaron comeback, but APX Void had it, he didn't even need it.
Yeah. He would have had that one minion which would have represented just enough damage to end the game. And yeah, he tried to play around, you know, the possibility of Yogg wiping his board, but as we mentioned before, there hadn't been that many spells played for Yogg.
Right.
And he ended up leaving himself open to the Azure Drake Swipe plus Living Roots, which his opponent had Emperor in place. So there's a lot of things his opponent can do that are not Yaxxaron against his board that can potentially get him back into the game, and that's exactly what happened.
Yeah, and that's also the worst case scenario. There's also a lot of times when Yogg doesn't do much. It kind of keeps it neutral. Also, might kill himself because he has such low health.
Right.
If you just cast a simple Hellfire or misdirect a damage spell, it could be really unfortunate. So I do feel like Lead Paint gave Yogg a little too much credit sometimes. Mm-hmm. You know, he is great, and he is our Lord and Savior, and we all bow down and worship him on a nightly basis. But sometimes you have to acknowledge that even an old god has its limitations.
It is sometimes the player who casts Yogg whose hopes are the one, in fact, end.
That's right. That's right. That is his name. So we're going into game four, potentially the last game of the series. APX Void, I believe, is just playing a C'Thun Warrior.
He's playing an interesting version of C'Thun Warrior. It's not the full-on commanding shout cycle C'Thun warrior, but he has a lot of those elements in the deck. He's running a lot of extra card draw, but he doesn't have the commanding shouts. He has one right. Pyromancer. It's kind of a hybrid style of C'Thun warrior.
He's got like loot hoarders in it, mm-hmm. which is a card that you normally see with the one turn kill worgen deck that you often see on ladder. So it's an interesting variation, something that I feel like he probably concocted himself as specific tech. He is banning other warriors, though, so it's not like it changed any of his matchups. Leadpaint's the one who left his warrior up, which is very surprising. I don't really expect to see many warriors being available unless you're specifically playing a Rena Warlock setup, which is what Leadpaint has, because he has that Rena Warlock to snipe the warrior.
Yeah, warrior, it has been, I think, the most popular class here as well as the most popular class the preliminary last weekend. Also, by far, the most banned class.
Yep.
So, lots of variations of the deck, but we barely get to see any of them because they're always banned.
It's true. Warrior actually has some really cool stuff, especially the control warriors that have Tink Master Overspark and a few other really cool techs in there. But no one wants to play against it.
All right, well, APX Void will get to play Warrior, one of the rare occasions that will happen in this tournament. And Leadpaint sends back his entire hand, definitely looking in this matchup to get his ramp on.
That's right. I think he's in a position where, you know, you can just win with the Druid. He has to win anyways. It will be one of those scenarios, too, where Leadpaint loses this game. His Druid has lost three games in the series. That would be quite unfortunate.
Yeah, he has really, you know, Ragnaros has let him down in these games. Or maybe he's let Ragnaros down. Who knows? What are the two? The Fire Lord has come to play quite a bit and has never quite gotten the job done.
Why is it always Leadpaint's fault? You know, maybe what if it's Yogg-Saron's the one at fault? He's the one who's the merciless guy.
Well, I think Ragnaros himself is pretty merciless. He enslaved all of the Dark Iron Dwarves. Did you know that Emperor Tharason's second greatest regret is allowing his people to be enslaved by a vengeful Fire Lord?
Isn't he summoning Ragnaros?
That's what happened.
Power?
He summoned, summoned Ragnaros, and Ragnaros enslaved his people.
Gotcha.
That's his flavor text.
And him, too.
Yeah, him as well.
Gotcha.
I don't know what his greatest regret is.
That sounds like a tough life.
You know, to think that's his second biggest regret. What's worse than that? What happened that's
letting
worse than
his
that?
Wife die?
Yeah,
perhaps?
Something like that. Yeah. But.
I would imagine that Emperor Thorazin is quite the sweetheart. Despite his, you know, his rugged looks, you might feel like he's a little hard around the edges, but he's a romantic dude.
Seems that way. Doesn't he kidnap Magni's daughter?
Oh, yeah, I heard about that.
I don't remember exactly how it goes, but we see the mulch coming out on the Acolyte of Pain.
That's how much he wants to stop his card draw. Just mulching a 1-3. There's plenty of targets that you would like to mulch, whether it's the Doom Callers or those big 4-6 Emperor Twins. However, you choose to mulch the Acolyte of Pain because you're just really respectful of all the card draw that this deck tries to generate.
Well, Leadpaint, you know, he had a hand of double Living Roots and really wanted to, I think, get in the board and not just allow APX Void to get massive value off of them.
Yeah. Again, some of these interesting choices for being able to draw a Gnomish Inventor. This is a card that you're supposed to play if you don't have any other good cards in your collection. You first started playing Hearthstone
a month ago. I don't own four drops, so I'll put this one in my deck.
You're like, well, I don't have at least Starseeker, so I guess I could just put in Gnomish Inventor.
Well, you know what card text is good? Draw a card.
It is
There's
good.
A lot of cards that say
what if,
that,
what if
and
it
a lot of them are in this deck.
Minion.
That's pretty good, too.
Mm.
But what if it says silence your own minion?
It's
a little worse.
Unplayable.
Wah, wah. I don't know if I call it unplayable. I would call it playable in specialized situations. I'm not going to go into it.
Yeah.
No purifies in this field just yet. And there probably won't be any ever. But
we might see Purify played before other cards in Hearthstone currently. There's definitely a lot of bad cards out there.
Well, Purify is like, but not even close to the worst card even in the set.
Okay. That is an opinion, and you are entitled to one.
Yes.
Yeah. Although, if there's one thing we can agree is that I don't think Warrior's in a bad position here. You can look at the hand, and it's got a lot of cycle, and that's kind of what the game plan wants to do. And you don't really compromise yourself too much with the C'Thun plan. In fact, you had the Doomcaller in there.
All right, and Leadpaint, he's, you know, in an okay spot. He's been able to get a little bit of his acceleration going here with the Mire Keeper. Rats down the Gnomish Inventor. But still, he's building to a end game, but his end game isn't necessarily as powerful in this matchup as it could be in a lot of others. And yeah, he's going to see his Mire Keeper go down, and board of motley minions for his opponent now, putting some pressure on.
Yeah, C'Thun Warrior has, you know, historically been a very problematic matchup for the Token Druid because they're so good at being resilient against all of your shenanigans of building the board. They can whirlwind your minions through Ravaging Ghoul. They can Fiery War Axe any early game minions you play with combination of Slam. They have single target removals, and they also have Brawl in case the board gets way too big to control. So, and then when you try to turn it on them, they have C'Thun to swing it back in their favor. It's very tricky, and it's a matchup that requires you to be very fast onto the board, and it's turn 8, or sorry, not it's turn 8, it's 8 mana turn for Lead Paint, and he still doesn't have a single minion stick.
Yeah, the warrior removal between Execute and Shield Slam, and the combination with Disciple of C'Thun here, is, you know, so many ways to deal with both large and small minions, and also just big boards of small minions thanks to the Ravaging Ghoul. Lots of ways to deal with everything that Lead Paint can throw at him, and you know, he's really, really struggling to find a way to hold on here.
Although he does have a pretty good amount of spells and he has a large hand, the big scary thing is that C'Thun Warrior is so good at grinding people out of resources. C'Thun, however, the cycle C'Thuns have gotten so much better at being able to tempo their opponent. Now, that sounds a little bit weird, but it's because once the board clears out, they're able to play a lot of these strong minions, and all of a sudden you can't come back from them. And then they draw C'Thun very consistently. Because a lot of times people always wonder, like, well, how often can I draw C'Thun? That's actually C'Thun Druid's biggest weakness. The fact that you play all these things leading up to C'Thun, and then you don't have C'Thun, and then you just play these minions for no reason. That's why a lot of the Druid decks debated for a long time about putting Nourishes in their deck. Like, should I put two or just one? And then he only settled on one.
It is time for Yogg-Saron already. Let's see what the God of Death has in store. We see APX Boy just kind of put his hands over his head. All right,
wow.
Well, that is a 9 damage Holy Wrath.
Jeez.
All right, and a Nourish.
That's going to
fill up Lead Paint's hand. Right. Prep.
Helps him weed through some of his spells.
A little bit more of a tempo turn.
Okay, Wrath for 3.
Backstab on his own Yogg.
Rampage is now live.
Innervate.
Oh, it's perfect.
Dark Bargain. Wow, this is such a huge swing from Yogg here.
Not bad.
Another Innervate.
He basically got to play with 16 mana this turn. No, wait. 18 mana this turn.
Wow, that turn was huge. Prep Living Roots into double Power of the Wild off of the Innervate.
Praise Yogg.
All right. Kill,
dang.
Kill all of your minions, put 15 power in play, go.
Draw cards.
Draw some cards.
He did burn a card. He burned his 5 teachers. In fact, both 5 teachers are gone because the Dark Bargains offered them. Was it worth it, Lead Paint? What happens to the nation if the teachers can't have a safe job? If you're just killing them off?
Lead Paint got dark real fast.
The thing is, like, his board. Okay, well, he does have Oknixia. I was thinking, like, if this board gets cleared, then what does he do to get back on the board? Because he's lost all his five features.
Oknixia.
Right. Yep. So I was saying that. But then his opponent has Ravaging Ghoul.
It's true. Yeah, Ravaging Ghoul and Execute the Bane of Oknixia.
Yeah. What now? If you have the Void Field tempted to use the Brawl right here, perhaps he can just execute the 9-5 and just. Let's play a little bit slower.
Yeah, it looks like he's debating getting some card draw going. Gonna go ahead and shield block, see what he can find. We'll just slam and digging for more.
That is an interesting slam target, I guess.
See the little raise of the eyebrows of Lead Paint? That was your turn?
Yeah, that was.
Draw some cards and play an Imp Master?
That was really curious.
He did. You know, he didn't address the board. By slamming Yogg, what does he accomplish here? He sets it up for
specifically. It's not like he's setting up for Baron Geddon or some other way.
In range of
Wild Pyromancer if he picks it up.
Okay, yeah, putting them both at 3 does mean that he can Pyromancer and he can't clear the board if they're all at 3 because he can't cast that many spells before the Pyromancer dies. But he could play Blood to Ichor and at least kill that with the Pyromancer.
Okay. There's only 5 cards left in Druid, by the way, so Lead Paint really has to make this work. Fire War Axe is another way you can clear this.
It will be Brawl for APX Void. Yeah, he does set up all but the Fendril now die to the Fire War Axe.
Okay.
And he does get one of the saplings as the brawl winner.
Mm-hmm. And Apex Void, why is he holding onto the coin, realizing that's going to be really important for the Pyromancer? But he still has 12 cards remaining, and only one of them is Pyromancer. That's a 9% chance or less to draw it. Lead Paint is just going to play a Nyxia, continue to put the pressure on. Even if Nyxia is cleared, he's got so many threats lined up. And he also does have finishing damage. Swipe and Starfire's 9 burst from the hand, maybe even more.
Wow, is he looking to Wild Growth? What is he trying to find?
I think he's trying to figure out how he wants to stagger his threats. Mm-hmm. If he plays Wild Growth, I almost feel like he's going to play Ancient of War or Ragnaros instead. Ancient of War is more resilient to whatever you want to play afterwards. Ragnaros is just most pressure.
All right, so he decides to leave Ragnaros, his faith in the Fire Lord. Get some damage in.
He always hits face in this case. This execute is nasty. I would like to see potentially the shield block, unless he wants to just play the Emperor Thors and not use the coin either. Okay.
Setting up Emperor Thorsen, keeping the coin, he could potentially drop Cthune, get the cost reduction on. Actually, not quite.
Well,
he needs a cost reduction on Cthune as well.
Right, you're supposed to reduce Bran.
If you reduce Bran and Cthune, you can explode your opponent in a single turn. Ooh, Azure Big plus swipe here will clear off the entire board.
Yeah, I'm not sure. Apex Void feels like he's rushing a little bit of his turns, too. He's playing very fast, and I think
there's Cthune.
Okay. So if he shield blocked, he would have gotten Cthulhu and played Emperor this turn, have the combo that we were talking about.
But Brandon, he cannot quite do it.
He still has
he is just
going to
fire off Cthulhu here,
And he should be able to kill the Azure Drake most of the time. Although it got kind of close, that last little tick there. That technical miss and just slapped the face. Who knows?
And I think Apex Void is deciding whether he wants to attack the face with this War Axe this turn, because he has a second War Axe. He's potentially setting up for a lethal attack the following turn.
I don't mind it. You do have to end the game eventually.
Yep.
And you're aware that your opponent draws his entire deck. He has Ancient of War. You just have to get past those
taunts. And now Lead Paint, he's facing the potential of lethal from Cthune. He definitely has to defend himself now.
And he's also facing fatigue.
Yeah.
Something that's very relevant, and if his opponent's able to get damage to the face at all.
He's now in a position, he previously played the Ragnaros, and the Ragnaros was able to be removed by a single execute. Now he's in a position where he cannot play the Onyxia, because the Onyxia would simply die.
Right.
Or he would simply die by getting attacked in the face by the Cthune. Mm-hmm. So he
needs to play Ancient of War.
He has to play Ancient of War or he dies. Or he could, I guess, no, he doesn't have the damage to kill it with Starfire plus Swipe is still off from being able to actually remove the 10-10 Cthune. So he 100%, I believe, has to play the Ancient. Or he doesn't know that there's another War Axe, but the attack to the face really suggests there's a War Axe. He could theoretically play Sylvanas plus Hero Power and not die immediately to fatigue, but then he's going to die to fatigue a turn later. So, yeah, he will go ahead and Ancient up.
Yeah, his best hope is that his opponent has to go through Cthune the hard way. He can remove Cthune and then play his own minion.
Mm-hmm.
But Apex Void is on a draw to potentially just kill this this Ancient of War off pretty easily. Let's see. How much damage? Yeah, he's got 5 damage from hand, plus the 1 from fatigue. Oh, no, he's got 4.
He has the
from
9
brand.
Damage from hand, because he can brand the...
Oh, you absolutely go for that. Get that damage in while you can. Let fatigue end this game, end this series.
As Cthune gets even bigger.
Yeah, it's unfortunate that he couldn't utilize this to buff Cthune to go for the attack directly to the health, but Apex Void is putting Lead Paint on his final turn, and that's going to wrap up the series. Our Canadian player goes yet another step further in the preliminary.
And those 3 games that Lead Paint struggled with that Druid deck, they all felt like there were just a ton of different options that he had available to him, and Ragnaros always let him down.
Yeah, it felt like he was not a son of fire in this case here. The night was very dark for Lead Paint and full of terrors.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's one of those situations where Lead Paint is going to have to pick himself up, and he is another player that's falling, but so are many players. And here to give us an update on what's been happening around the preliminary is TJ over at the Blackboard.
Thank you very much, Dan. That's right. There's been a lot of action happening around the whole preliminary. We're starting to get towards the end of day number one, which means that there's a lot of players eliminated. I'm joined with Admirable. He's here to help me give some updates. But right away, let's go ahead and start getting right into these regions and see which players are left remaining. We had some updates earlier. Chess Dude fell as well. And we're going to get to see in a second here exactly who's left. We started with 168, and now we're down to less than half of that Admirable. 70 remain.
Yeah, that's the nature of double elimination, as you will quickly thin out the field as the rounds start to pour out. And here you can see every single one of those red strikes means it's been two match losses so far, and they'll have to wait until next time to try to make their dreams come true.
Yeah, but there's still a lot of well-known names, unlike Europe, where each region, it seems like some of these players, Hot Form, Dwayne, Fibonacci, all of these big names, Chalky still left, as we saw earlier.
Yep.
And definitely a lot still left.
All of Luminosity Gaming is actually still left in this event and putting up quite a big finish. And here you can see the Tavern Heroes. Oh, it's been rough for that group.
Yeah, and we also have some footage from the venue in Tennessee that's hosting one of these fireside gatherings. Have a few players there, so a little bit calmer there than what we've seen, but definitely you can tell they're enjoying some Hearthstone. Hopefully they're enjoying their event as well.
Yeah, I mean, every time I've been to Esports Arena to participate, it's been a blast. A lot of camaraderie between the players. It's almost like everyone there rallies behind you, even though you're all kind of against each other. Yeah. It's a really cool feeling.
Some regional pride going on there is definitely a thing. Even though everybody's against each other at that venue, it's kind of cool. But let's go over some of the updates quickly. Lots of players being eliminated. Chess Dude has been eliminated. Amnesiac took a win over Deninja, but then Amnesiac actually went on to lose his next match, so he's going to be eliminated as well. Frozen falls down, but he's going to go to the lower bracket, and Firebat is out.
Yep, last chance for the former world champion to make another BlizzCon appearance, but when you only compete in one of the preliminaries, it's tough to pull out a win from just one of those. So unfortunately, he'll have to wait till next year.
Yeah, and so that means we won't have a world champion, a former world champion at this year's BlizzCon, so we're guaranteed to have a new world champion, unless Artosis from 2013 finally manages to
going way back on this one.
He manages to find a victory.
Does live in Korea.
He does, so he could participate in the Asia Pacific. I don't know. Artosis isn't making it. Don't get your hopes up if you're an Artosis fan. But let's go ahead and flip this board over. We got some names to eliminate, Admirable.
Yep. It always hurts to scratch these names off the board, but that is the nature of Hearthstone tournaments. You can't win everyone, and many players will be eliminated from this. Fortunately for me, my two are still in the running.
Yeah, but you can go ahead and eliminate Chess Dude. So Soddle actually has one down. And Kibler, unfortunately, has one down as well, as we're going to go ahead and cross out Firebat there.
Yep, Frodan also has one pick going down with the winter champion himself, the young savage Amnesiac.
Yeah.
Who is out of the tournament as well at this point.
Might as well. No repeat champions. That's actually a really poor X.
I think it looks fantastic. Just like you.
It's got a little bit of flair to it. But yeah, still a lot of players in the ring. Chalky, Just Saying, Rosti. Admiral, you're actually the only person who has both of your picks left.
Yeah, I honestly, the Yowitz Flo spot was really interesting to me. I thought about picking Muzzy. I was like, I think Flo's going to perform better. Muzzy, of course, beats Flo in the set they play against each other.
He's in the lower bracket. But we just eliminated two names, Chess Dude and Firebat, from Soddle and Kibler. And they're actually going to be bringing us the next match. So let's see how sad they actually are.